So, very good morning to all the participants from India. Hello and welcome to all the participants joining from different countries for this live session or listening to us later on during any part of the day so that you can also learn through this session. So, this is basically the fourth live session of the Life Skill MOOC and will be based on the modules of the fourth week, in which we have already talked about, our experts have discussed about ethics and their genesis and theories of ethics. We have already gone through ethics in specifically in engineering field, as we are focusing on life skill in engineering. Then code of ethics nationally as well as internationally, we have been talking about in our videos, in our modules. Ethical dilemmas, which is, I think, a very, very important area. Hierarchy of moral values, factor affecting the moral responsibility and degree of responsibility. These are the major areas which we have covered during this week module. If you have already visited the videos, check the resources. That's great. Otherwise, you can anytime log into the Life Skill MOOC portal and visit these modules and enhance your knowledge about these topics. First of all, I have to welcome all the experts here. Mr. Ataluri Vishwanath, he is the industry expert. Ms. Ramya Chittarappu, she is a research fellow at Department of Political Science in University of Hyderabad. Dr. Manasranjan Panigrahi, SPO SEMCA. So today we will be starting our presentation with Ms. Ramya Chittarappu. She is a research fellow at Department of Political Science in University of Hyderabad, India. She's very actively engaged with MOOCs, not just with the MOOCKit platform. She's also engaged with Swayam platform, creating, developing, and running a MOOC out there also. So she's a good expert of the field as well as the technical she also has got the technical understanding of the MOOCs. Welcome you all in this live session, and I'll invite Ms. Ramya Chittarappu to share her screen and start the presentation.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much, Monica, for that very exciting and a presentation early in the morning. So back here in Hyderabad today, after beating a lot of heat, we have a very cloudy weather. So the weather is also adding up to the excitement of this presentation today. And a very good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all the participants across from different countries who are joining in for this ethics module and the presentation. So I'm Ramya Chittarappu, as Ms. Monica mentioned, and I'm a doctoral research scholar at the Department of Political Science, University of Hyderabad. And we have been into this MOOC, Life Skills MOOC, which is, you know, under the aegis of Commonwealth and SEMCA and IIT Kanpur. We've been doing this MOOC for the last 3 years. And Professor Rama Brahmam, who is the course coordinator, the module coordinator for this particular module, was unable to join us. But under his leadership, this MOOC has seen a lot of active participation from participants across the country. And it has been very encouraging for us to come back to this MOOC every year. And we keep waiting to engage with the participants and the forums and discussions on this. So without much delay, I will start sharing my screen. And like already mentioned to you, in this particular webinar, as all the learners must be following, we are doing this particular week on ethics and ethics in engineering profession. What are its challenges? And probably in the level two, we will be looking at the case studies on ethics and all those, the nuances associated with ethical decision making. So today, when we were discussing or when we decided the topic for today, like Mr. Vishwanath is also going to join us and he would give his inputs. based on all his industry experiences, it has been one of the critical junctures where we thought talking about ethical dilemmas is very important. Because when we talked about ethical dilemmas in the last 2 years, ethical dilemmas then was something about how engineers should take decisions, how engineers should make decisions more ethical and all. But now we are talking about a new world called post-COVID world. So everything is now associated or affected by COVID. So as I share my presentation, just a second, Monica, can you please enable screen share for me?
Can you share?
Yeah. Yes. Can you see my screen?
It's starting to share, maybe taking a minute.
Yeah. I hope you can see my screen now.
Yes, I can.
So we are here, we're talking in this webinar on ethical dilemma and how to address it in real life situations. So the participants must have already got an introduction onto what is ethics and what is it about, we are not going into the deeper details about it. So the one point agenda or the objective of this webinar is dealing with ethical dilemma and how to address it in real life situations. So giving a little bit of intro before we move on to the actual topic. So when we're talking about engineering and ethics, engineers, like we have seen, are an inherent part of the society. So as professionals, they are undoubtedly an inherent part of our society. And right from the invention of a safety pin to the working of Mars rover and the recently developing technologies on COVID vaccines and a lot of other things that are developing in the pre and post COVID world, everything, the processes and products, there are engineers behind it. So with this advent of technologies and the greater public good, there is always a need that, you know, the engineers are targeted at. So in this kind of a situation, when we are talking about vaccinations and COVID, who gets first and which vaccine to take and so many other things, there's an underlying feature in all of it, which is called as ethics. And so today, particularly, we are talking about engineering ethics, which is now becoming a part of the engineering curricula, as well as ethics and professional ethics, which are becoming part of different academic curricula across the world. So the reason behind is quite simple. Like if for instance, we have to tell you, decision making like engineering design may have multiple, you know, solutions. If there is a problem, there is a way in which I would deal with it, or there would be a way in, Mr. Vishwanath dealing with it, and there would be multiple different ways. But all that underlying thread amongst all of it is ethics. So when rapid advances in technology and speed of implementation are creating more complex scenarios, there is always a need for identification and management of risks, and its mitigation is very vital. So when it comes to conduct of an engineer in the society, like we have said, engineers are involved in every process and every part of our lives. So conduct of an engineer in the society is of utmost importance, and it is here that we are talking about ethical decision making. So engineers shall hold paramount the safety, health, and welfare of the public. So in the wake of globalization and the advent of digital technologies and the ensuing complexities in the post-COVID world, it is but imperative for engineers to develop their capabilities and inculcate and imbibe life skills, of which ethics is a very important part. And when we come to the actual part of ethics, we're talking so much about ethics and, you know, being ethical and all. As we have seen, right from our smallest decision to make, like for instance, today early morning, it is 8 a.m. in the morning and the webinar. And, there are a lot of times we have these dilemmas on whether to do it or not, whether to take this decision or not, for various reasons. And that is why when we talked about it, we are saying ethics is not always black and white. So what might be ethical ethical to me might be something else to my superior, or what might be ethical to me might my subordinate might have a different perspective. So when we are talking about ethics in black and white, there are a lot of times there are so many gray areas. So that's why ethical situations are not always clear, but they come in a number of shades of gray. And what might be appropriate in one situation might not be appropriate in another. So I think in the future course of this course, you would be looking at ethical case studies on ethics, where some ethical decision making would have changed the fate or would have changed the prospects of certain projects. So what happens, what is the ethical decision that is taken today might not apply in a real life situation tomorrow. For instance, what were the solutions that we were working with in the pre-COVID world might have taken a totally different ethical stand when it comes to the post-COVID world that we are dealing with today. So here this is where I would like to introduce the topic where we're talking about ethical dilemmas. A lot of times we are stuck between two decisions, right? From choice, like choosing between two things. When it comes to bigger decisions in professional ethics and bigger decisions in professional spheres, there is always that, you know, a dilemma where we have to decide whether which is good or which is bad, or which is ethical or which is unethical. And especially in scenarios which involves a lot of individuals and technologies and their lives, there is always a need to be ethically informed to make ethical decisions. So now I think I will hand it over to Mr. Vishwanath, who will take it from here on what are ethical dilemmas, to how, as an industry expert with more than 35 or close to 40 years of experience, how he has dealt with ethical dilemmas. Over to you, Mr. Vishwanath.
Thank you, Ramya. Before Mr. Vishwanath take up, I'll just introduce him to our participants. Dear participants, learners, we have with us Mr. Ataluri Vishwanath. He's an industry expert, basically an electrical engineer from NIT Rourkela, India. And he has been working with different national level agencies for large power projects in the conventional and renewable energy. And he comes with a long experience, and I think he's actually a right person to take us through the case studies and the real life scenarios being an engineer. And now I welcome Mr. Vishwanath for his part of the presentation. Over to you, sir. Sir, you're muted.
Hello, students, working professionals, employees, my colleagues, and friends. I'm happy to share my own experiences on this particular topic. As Ramya has mentioned, this is really a dilemma where the practicing engineers or students, we may discuss a lot of theory about what type of ethics and what are the theories behind various types of ethics. But ultimately, it is in the practice, in the day-to-day life, what exactly we do, how we are governed by the courts. And as you'll be seeing in this lecture or in the course which has been introduced to you, we have introduced many case studies, at least 5 or 6 case studies, you'll be seeing it. And then you can correlate on what we are talking today. And after that, if you once again go through this particular video, you'll make an alignment between what we are telling today and what we are speaking in the case studies. I'll straight away come to the point. Yeah, we all discuss about the post-COVID world, but many of the points what we make here is also was already prevailing in the pre-COVID world also. See, businesses or institutions or companies go through extreme pressures, particularly now because of the different situation. There could be reduced sales or drop in revenues or job losses or increased overheads. So in every aspect of this, there is some sort of, I will not say stress or tension, but some sort of a layer behind in the mind that what are we doing? And particularly in the competitive world, we need to be much more careful now on this particular aspect, because any decision engineers take has a long repercussions and implication in the society. So moral and ethical decision making assumes more significance in the present context, and the challenging and the enforcing of this ethical code of conduct. It may be a rule book in the almanacs of the companies, but how much you are really adopting this and how much you are applying your own mind, and during this dilemma, what exactly you are doing is what we thought we'll share with all of you. Actually, the leaders must have confidence that their employees at all levels will act at high integrity. And despite these turbulent times, companies believe that operating with corporate integrity can create major benefits for the organization. It's a brand, what we call. It is here your actions of your people, your employees, and your boards, which will be looked into in improving the brand and also creating a long life living companies. Next. See, now we'll come to the real subject of dealing with ethical dilemma and how to address this in the real lives. See, ethical problems in engineering rarely have a single readily deduced solution. It may contain a range of solutions that are clearly right, relatively better, or may not be appropriate for that particular situation. It is here that the engineer faces the critical challenge, and it is that important that critical thinking and effective decision making, and we apply our own common sense sometimes in addition to the code of conduct in selecting, because I'm talking about the real life situation. We have gone through many examples which I'll be telling in the end. And the principles and values that we choose as professionals are so critical for solving these ethical problems. There are instances where one has to decide between right and wrong, instances when we have to decide whether to go to the next step or retract. So our presentation will be a combination of theory, which we have dealt with in our course, and practical solutions, which we'll be dealing in this particular webinar. There is a particular model which I'll introduce here. It's a Kantian model, which helps us to take inputs during an ethical dilemma situations. And we will be discussing this particular theory. This is a part of deontological ethical theory compared to the other one, which is utilitarian theory. Next. See, in a Kantian model for practical implementation in for all ethical issues, a decision is truly moral only if it made by an autonomous rational decision maker. And rationality is the guide used by all humans with free choice to fulfill the moral law. What it says is every act is an end to itself. The human beings are not a means to an end. If you feel that particular act in a series of many acts, that particular act is correct, right or wrong, you decide then and there and take the right decision there. Compared to the utilitarian way in which the final good is what he says is a ethically good act. Kant has placed the highest worth on performing moral duty, which is nothing but the rational decision making. The actions undertaken from moral duty rather than compulsion or law are important. Again, this is very important. There is no compulsion nor any other influence. He is taking based on the moral duty of that particular activity. People need to be treated as an end in them and never as a means to an end, which I was mentioning. The companies and institutions also need to respect the individual decision-making free will. It's not just that the individual is responsible and we also pounce on him that you take a decision and whether it's right or wrong. The companies and institutions play a lot of role in not only the framing the rules in letter and spirit, but in spirit also, they should be encouraging the individuals in making free will decisions. A company's brand name takes years to develop, and hence its most valuable asset is the brand. If the trusted brand causes harm to the customer, then I think it can do irreparable damage. So this is what we meant on the Kantian model, the individual taking decision company supporting them and having policies in supporting that particular decision, which creates a huge brand and moving forward. Next. Is a block diagram which explains the Kantian model, and where the individuals, before taking decision, see, there is an individual, there is a company, there is society and the country. This particular thing talks about the individual and the company or the group. There is an autonomy section, there is a question section, and next we'll be showing two more areas in the value chain. In this section, before taking a decision, this I'm talking about the theory. We'll have immediately come to a practical situation on how this theory has been applied to the practice. The individual needs to ask a question himself. Am I acting from the basis of reason alone, or there is some other overall perspective which I need to be taking into consideration? Can I rule out, number one, political influence of the decision which I'll be taking? Is there a monetary influence, or it's a pure self-interest on my promotion or on my name and fame? So you need to ask these questions himself. This is the first step. And if the answer is yes, that is, there is no political influence or monetary influence or pure interest, it's an individual decision, the free will. If it is no, then it is immediately, the decision is given to the larger group. It can be with along with his boss or along with the small group which is working, or the task force in which he is in charge of the project. So it goes into the group. In the group or as an individual, the next decision box is, could I obligate everyone else, whoever is in a similar situation? Would I accept this decision if I were on the receiving end? And have I faced a similar ethical issue before? This important questions after the autonomy section will give rise to some more clarity on where we need to go. It may appear to be a longer process and a lot of pressure on the brain, but it is not. Once we go through these questions, and once this is a part and parcel of our day-to-day work, it becomes as simple as applying these questions to ourselves on each and every decision and going to the next step. Next. The ethical consideration triangle, which we have put, duty is one corner, dignity and respect, and the intention on why we are doing. And in this triangle, we have the three groups of self, the company, and the society. So we need to consider each point of the triangle with each group inside. The company may have a duty, dignity and respect, and an intention, the vision and purpose, what we say. The society at large. I'll be giving some examples as we move forward. And once we address these three issues, we need to communicate the final decision. And after analyzing the decision of the individual or the group, and then a formal and informal research need to be done to understand what decisions we are taking, how impact they are having in the society or on the larger end of the project and on the schedules and timelines. So this is a theoretical model which you have put here, and we'll be seeing next how we apply this to the practical situations which we face. Next. This is an ethical approach, as we were discussing, utilitarian, deontological, the virtues and fairness and justice. Why we have put here is, we need to consider these following areas before taking a decision. I'll just give a simple example here. And I also please focus on the second sentence which you have put here. Select the one after addressing the consequences of each of the models, our ethical theories, and for every consequence and result, test the model again. The importance here is, suppose there is a huge dam which is being constructed, and decision has to be taken to do a land acquisition for this particular dam of, say, thousands of acres, say 5,000 acres or 6,000 acres of land required. There are 8 to 10 villages and people are living there, and you need to take a decision. Generally, decisions on such large projects are taken based on the utilitarian principle, where the final good is important, and a little bit of suffering or sacrifices can be not set aside, but can be addressed. So decision is taken based on in this filter criteria, the utilitarian decision is taken, which passes through the filters of these particular ethical approaches. But after taking the decision, there are the 10 villages which need to be rehabilitated and resettled. The advice here is we need to use deontological approach here, the Kantian model, because those individuals who have been displaced or we have to find a new way of life for them, we need to understand what has to be done to them, what is fair, and based on the ethical principles of Kantian philosophy, the individuals need to be taken the right decision. Are they getting the benefits of the project? The promises made by in the R&R policy are being implemented or not? So in the same project, there could be two approaches, utilitarian and deontological, where decisions are taken and the final ethical practices are implemented. Next. See, dealing with this ethical dilemma, declaring a project as complete without all systems and functionals with safety aspects and supplying power. Here, I will actually put, this is the first example. It's actually a thermal project. It's a live example. A thermal project has some 60 to 70 subsystems. And suppose we have decided that on 31st of December, in a particular year, the project will be declared as commercially complete and technically fulfilled all the aspects, including the safety aspect. And we have declared that power will start flowing from this and the project will start making money. This is a noble cause in which there are thousands of villages which will be getting power from this particular project. Now, there have been areas of concern where engineers face extreme pressure to declare completion in spite of issues due to organizational commercial reasons and also to meet the schedules promised by to the boards and to the ministry. Very important. Every one of us during our career have gone through or will be going through, and students to remember this particular aspect. Then in your career, it may be a thermal project, it can be a chemical project, it can be anything which during the subsequent you'll be learning in the case studies with the Bhopal gas tragedy or Fukushima nuclear disaster. You can correlate what we are telling. Second thing is the unrealistic assumptions in the project feasibility reports. See, in order to impress the lending agencies, many assumptions are put in the project. Here the example is, there was an hydro project and during the project, they have made some assumptions and submitted to the bank to lending agencies that this project will make so and so IRR or so much of revenue in the next few years. These are based on some assumptions that water will be flowing adequately and we'll have enough of water level to feed not only the farmers but also to generate power. But in the anxiety of the commercial aspects coming into the level, these are some of the projects may fail. What I'm telling here is the individuals or the companies very well know that some of the assumptions are not right during the commencement of the project. Here, the individuals who are going to approve or individuals who are going to be commissioning the project have to keep in line the ethical practices and take decisions accordingly. Third bullet here is the anxiety to draw funds and commence project without realizing the project may be delayed and may not be able to meet the stated objectives. Here one example again is a hydro project where there was enough water in the reservoir and the banks were convinced that yes, we can go ahead. But one engineer has clearly told, he's put his foot down and said that we cannot go forward on the project, telling that till next 5 years, the gates cannot be opened because the water flow, even though when the gates is opened, the total eye cut, which leads to the final farming is not ready. And it was true. Even 10 years from now, the project has been approved. This project could not be commissioned because the final canals and the layout and everything was not ready. So when it has to be very clearly told, we should not get me in the influence of the political or the commercial or the other aspects of banking system and take decisions. And declaring results which does not reflect the actual performance outcome. We have the distribution companies in India. We have seen for the last so many years, the technical losses or aggregated commercial losses are being declared in order to, you know, impress or to keep the brand image high. These particular reforms, where we have put very clearly that the actual numbers or the actual results have to come out rather than, you know, giving some numbers to impress the banking system or for our own brand image. These engineers who are working in these particular organizations at that particular stage and phase of their life have to be open and apply the deontological theory rather than an utilitarian. Utilitarian is for the levels where, you know, decisions are taken in a different way. So this particular suggestion from us, that which theory to apply for which decision making at what level and stage of life of the engineer or in the organization, goes a long way in dealing with this ethical dilemma. There is a theory of A or B, and there is a method of clearing this. So we can correlate these particular aspects when we are actually doing our further course on the case studies and also on the theory of how to apply and where to apply. We thought we'll bring this theory and practical examples in front of us, and we'll be ready to take questions and address any of the questions which you'll be having in view. Thank you very much.
A couple of things if I could add on the previous slide. So this is one of the neat parts of this presentation where we're talking about the practical aspects of the decision making. Like Mr. Vishwanath was talking about, you know, having that funnel and the different approaches of making a decision. So I think the learners who are enrolled in the course would be dealing with this particular approaches in this, probably they would have seen the lecture already. So a little bit about, like, you know, a lot was talking about the example. So I will just give you a brief on the utilitarian, deontological, fairness and justice and virtues, and probably then we will open up for questions. So like sir was telling, so teleological ethics, or, you know, the utilitarian talks about the consequences. So there is a lot of times where we're talking about the outcomes or actions of, you know, the decisions that we are making. And then it deals with the questions like, how is it going to affect? What are the consequences of the decision? So a lot of times in our personal lives and in our professional lives, it is all about, you know, we make a decision. Sometimes we make it for ourselves, but a lot of times there are situations, both in our personal lives and professional lives, where we have to take the other people into consideration. And especially as engineers, as professionals, you develop technologies, or you develop processes, or you might even write just one document which would go out to public. So there is always every stage of your life, whether it is implicitly or explicitly, where we talk about ethics. So when we talk about utilitarian ethics and Kant, Immanuel Kant, where there's a lot of emphasis on greater good of the greater, you know, greater happiness of the greater number of people. And then when we come on to the deontological ethics, deontological ethics is basically about, you know, duty based. So how much of, you know, whether whatever decision you make, whether it is like a duty that you're doing it, or what, how is the decision going to affect basically? And when it comes to fairness and justice, just like the name suggests, fairness and justice is about how fair are you in your decision and how just are you in your decision. And like sir was repeatedly telling, and I would also reiterate, all this would actually fall in place when you deal with the case studies that of ethics that you'd be dealing with in the level 2 of this ethics module. And this is the theoretical part of it, for you to develop an understanding of the theory. And when you look at the practical aspects, you can easily place this in this framework. So probably after this week's course, you will also be, next time when you're trying to make a decision, be it ethical decision or any decision, you would at least for a second think about, you know, one of these frameworks. And when it comes to virtues is largely, it deals with the center of morality and the good character of an individual. So virtues is largely, you know, it constitutes to the personal ethics. while we also try and be professional, there's a lot of times that our personal self is also carried. So our personal self affects our professional ethics. Our personal lives or the personal contexts and surroundings in which we live affects our professional decisions. So virtues also is a type of normative ethics which emphasizes on the inherent character of a person rather than on the nature or the consequences of those decision making and all that. And so now I think we are open to take questions. And last, we leave with you with this question on which theory or model to adopt in situations where you have to make a decision. So I think now I will hand it over to Monica.
Yes. Yes, thank you, Ms. Ramya and Mr. Adaluri Vishwanath, for the very informative and very connecting kind of presentation where you have given the meaning and understanding of a particular theory and a framework, and sir has connected it with the real life situation and given small examples also wherever it was possible for him. There are a few questions, not many, I'll say. I think this is not directly from the presentation, but it is coming more from the module of our this week. That is, what is result of hierarchy of moral values? This is one of the questions which has come up from the participants. If you can just.
Ramya.
I'll repeat the question once again. What is the result of hierarchy of moral values?
Okay. Monica, can we take all the questions so that, both of us can, shift and answer the questions? Can you also tell us the remaining questions?
Yeah, there's one more question. Is there a possibility or something like this, that all the four frameworks which have been talked about, the ethics, are taken together for any kind of case study or any incident or any kind of example, or most of them have been employed for a certain case? That's the only question, two questions right now we have.
I will take the second question of applying all together. Maybe I'll address that first. You're talking about the various theories of ethical and applying. Yes, I think as a practicing engineer, first of all, at what stage in his life he is there is very important. Suppose he is at a entry level or a junior engineer or just 3 or 4 years of his engineer, and he's working on a particular segment, very focused. He is not in charge of 4 or 5 areas and he's not a manager or a senior manager where you need to manage the things. Technical, purely, I think it has to be a Kantian principles which needed to follow then and there. Whether that particular act, as the theory says, it's not means to an end, it's an end. It's a digital, 0 or 1. Whether this particular thing I need to do, suppose he's doing a testing of a electrical equipment and he finds that equipment has not passed the 5 tests which he is doing. And next activity is somebody else has to charge that equipment and really connect that into the system. And there is a deadline of that particular thing. He need not worry about the deadline. He need not worry about what's going to happen next. His job is that these 5 tests he has to complete, apply Kantian principle, deontological theory, and go ahead. The next level, when a manager has to, he's a 10 years experience, something like that. And he also has a practical in him that he need to take a decision based on the same equipment I'm telling. It's a transformer has to be charged or something like that. And he has to commission the transformer. And after charging that, there are some villages which will get electrified. And he has promised the villagers that he will be giving the power supply. And he sees that out of this 5 tests, his engineer has not accepted, and he has given a report very clearly that one particular test he has he has not passed it, and he will not clear it for charging of the DIP equipment. This manager or a senior manager level, if he wants to take a decision on utilitarian principle, that how much the test is actually going to create a damage on that particular transformer, or whether it is going to create not giving power supply or getting delayed, or how much is the delay, there will be a debate. If you see that Kantian theory, I said when the answer is not in influence of any external pressure, then it's a group which comes into picture. So they sit down together, and before applying the utilitarian principle, they will threadbare discuss that how much time it's going to take. Suppose in a week's time, you can address the one of the tests which has not passed, and you can commission the transformer for 1 week. Still, I feel Kantian principle has to be applied, not utilitarian. Complete the test in 1 week. Suppose it is found that it will take a month or so, and there is an issue and other things, and the test is not going to impact from the safety and aspect or any other aspect of that particular thing, and it can go. Then they take the other decision of whether to go ahead or not. But and of course the virtue and other things are always there. It is like good and bad, truth and false, lies and non-lies. But in this example, this one will be, even though we have 4 or 5 types of theory, Kantian theory is the best. After 39 to 40 years of experience in this industry, I feel that small minor mistakes done or using a utilitarian principle and taking decision has actually 9 out of 10 times resulted in failure at some point of other, which is, we say the stitch in time saves 9, has resulted in a failure rather than anything else. So as a practicing engineer, the schedules are important, no doubt. The pressure is important, no doubt. But I can, with my conviction, I can say that Kantian and deontological theory is the best as far as concerned. Others are to be decided. And even if they have taken a utilitarian principle point of view, the other decisions which are postponed or which are not taken, again, we have to apply the Kantian principle for that also. Like I was telling the R&R that you apply, whether the individual has got the land, alternate land, whether it has got the supply. So there you again use the ethical principle and resolve it. So it's a part of 10 utilitarian and 90 as deontological. And in the 10 again, you start applying deontological theory and go on this. So you refine your ethical practice in such a way that ultimately you are doing what is right, good for the society. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now, I think the next question was to be answered by Ms. Ramya.
Yes. So here, I think we were talking about moral, hierarchy of values. Hierarchy of values, when you talk about it, I think a little bit of introduction about moral, what are moral values, what are non-moral values, have to be understood for a basic understanding. So a lot of times, values and when you're talking about moral values and non-moral values, moral values are which are in the purview of our ethics. For example, honesty or trying to be punctual or trying to be loyal. So these fall under moral values. Non-moral values probably means your preferences of color or your preferences of sports and etc. So when we're talking about an individual holistically, a lot of times we are made up of both moral values as well as non-moral values. And when we are trying to talk about hierarchy of moral values, when we are getting there, you're also a combination of your personal self and a professional self. So when you're talking about hierarchy of moral values, especially in terms of ethics, what happens is the different values that we have, there is an individual A, there is an individual B. Individual A has a set of values about, say, honesty, punctuality, and loyalty. Individual B is hardworking. Individual B is very truthful. Individual B is, he is very up to date about technologies and all that. So all of us as individuals come with different, like just like how we are unique individuals, we also come with unique value systems. So when we are trying to place hierarchy of moral values, just like the name suggests, you are trying to put your moral values in a hierarchy. So by hierarchy, what we mean is the values are arranged according to their importance and relevance. And some values are very important and some may be less relevant. And suppose in this particular, you know, if I look at it, I was supposed to be here by 8 o'clock. So my punctuality mattered more there rather than me being honest or rather than me being hardworking. There at that point of time, the punctuality is what mattered to be on time there. So when you look at bigger decisions, like sir was talking about on bigger hydro projects or thermal projects, or, you know, including management decisions that you are supposed to make, there are a lot of times that even in moral values, when we segregate, we have professional values, we have spiritual values. Some people come with a set of spiritual values and they try to base their decisions on the spiritual values that they have. And some people come with a very professional attitude and they try to put all their or base all their decisions on the professional values that they carry. So even their personal decisions that they make are strategic. They look at an equation and they say, okay, this, and so this gives rise to this. So it is important for individual to have that hierarchy of values. And here, when we are talking about hierarchy of values, we thought as individuals or as engineers or as professionals, it is important for all of us to understand what is the set of values that we carry. When I say I'm honest, if I'm not practically honest, then that does not count as a value. So the hierarchy of values is not the same for everybody, but differs from one person to, you know, the other. And it guides the individual's behaviors, and it's also their inspirations, their interests. And when an individual is making a decision in an organization at a professional level, that decision would affect at different levels. And sometimes it might be the management decision, or sometimes it becomes an organizational decision. So it is important for individuals, institutions to have those hierarchy of values on what is important for them and what is it that guides their decisions. And and also another interesting fact about hierarchy of values is it tends to change at every stage of our lives. Like we are saying, not all decisions, not all value systems are, you know, tailor-made or they are one-size-fits-all approach. So my value system might be different from a professional working in an engineering corporation. As a doctoral research scholar, I have to have my research ethics. I have to have my ethics before I go and question people on a survey method. So whereas Mr. Vishwanath will have a different value system to deal with the problems in the industry and on the field. So while some people may prefer to give top preference to their professional values, there are people who might give, you know, preferences to their spiritual values when they make decisions. In this hierarchy of values, basically depends upon three major factors. One is your individuals, second is your values, and third is your situation in which the individuals are. So when the individuals decide their values based on the needs and interest, their professional conditions and so on, that is how the individual is factored into this hierarchy of values. The second important thing is the values themselves. Like we have already discussed so much, every individual brings their own set of values, and this kind of brings in that significance in the hierarchy. And the last factor is very important, the situation in which individuals live and work. So the situation in which I'm working is a work from home atmosphere. So the situation in which I am working might affect my ethical decision making at this point of time. Similarly, like it has been for a lot of situations in life, it is always important for us to understand what is the context in which we are operating. So ethics, ethical dilemmas, and ethical decision making is largely dependent on the context in which and the situations in which we are operating. And lastly, I think when we are talking about hierarchy of moral values in professional life, we should understand that we have to be and we have to always up ourselves or skill up ourselves to have the highest value systems, because it is not a decision that is affecting me, but it is affecting an organization, it is affecting an institution, and at large, in the larger picture, it affects a community and a society. So it is important for us to have that hierarchy and values in the first place, and then the hierarchy of values and our adherence to all these value systems and hierarchy of values that we are setting up. And finally, I think all these put together will finally help us, you know, crack that ethical dilemmas and, you know, make us better decision makers for the greater good of the society. So over to Monica for any further questions.
Thank you, Ramya. It was really, really, I think, very detailed reply to this question. I think the reply was really, to me, it was very, enlightening that in such simple words, with such simple situations, you've answered it. And I can also feel that, okay, this value system, as you said, may vary for individual to individual, but I think it may vary for an individual to location or situation to situation also. I being here as a professional, I being at home as a housewife, I being as mother to a child, or I think everywhere it will change. Which value will prevail at what level will change in all the situations. So very well explained, Ramya. And Vishwanath sir, you have given a very, very good answer to the question of this Kantian model is the good approach. I also, with the little knowledge I have of these models, I've also attended this course in the previous run also to understand, fine, it's for engineers, I'm not an engineer, but still life skills is a very, very important aspect. And now we are also listening that the soft skills and life skills, the person who has it, will be surviving in the professional life more than anybody, any technical expert of the field, because these are the life values which are getting somewhere, we are missing it nowadays. So we need to focus on these skills. And this course is also, you know, kind of helping us, helping the engineers, helping the participants to move towards this kind of system where, apart from the work, we are also focusing on the skill part of it and life skills, or I'll say soft skills, which are very, very important as a social, we as a social being.
Thing with all engineering friends and practicing engineers and students of engineering, given a chance to me, there should be no dilemma in ethics. Actually, there should be no dilemma. Ethics is like zero or one, whether the particular result is acceptable or not acceptable. It's a technical thing. So engineers need not have in their mind a pressure on them that what decision to be taken. Its code of conduct is very clear in front of them. What needs to be done, whether it is a test or whether decision, very clearly articulated in the technical documentation. Please adhere to that technical documentation and have no pressure on you of any other decision. Your responsibility is to clear that particular instance. Be on your responsibility. Adhere to the technical standards and test what you need to do and take the decision. And if he has to be right no on a particular thing, please write no without any doubt in your mind of any pressure on political or commercial or societal pressure. It is not for you. You have been engineers for a technical aspect point of view. You have been trained to be an engineer. Continue to be an engineer in your life and call a spade a spade. Don't deviate from that. If this happens at every level, if there is a delay of 15 days on a particular supply or water supply or a power supply, rather than, you know, getting into some different aspect, it's better to then and there clear it and go to the next step. All our case studies which are shown will bring this particular aspect very clearly. So for an engineer, ethics is only one, zero or one, good or bad.
I think it is like wearing a mask and sanitizing your hands during the corona times. There is no saying no to this. We have to be very careful for, handling this kind of situation, whether we are vaccinated or we are not vaccinated, but we should be very, very careful. So I just trying to relate the real life situation which we are facing as a person here, and whatever you are saying is very, very relevant to us. So I'll be now, we are at the end. We have already exceeded the time limit. Before I conclude, if you have, sir has already given kind of his last words. Ramya ma'am, if you have any last words to say, then I'll just maybe sum up the session.
I think when I was talking about hierarchy of moral values, it's, you know, when we talk about a lot of things and when we talk about ethics and all, and like we're talking about life skills, and when, if I have to talk about the overview of this course as such, you know, we're talking about life skills. So when we get skilled, it is important for us to not just get that certificate and finish it, but it is important for us to practice it. And the whole effort of these life skills and ethics is to bring about that change in the thought process of people. And especially in this, you know, there is a lot of emphasis on the post-COVID and the present ongoing second wave and third wave and all that. It is important for us to be ethical. It is important for me to wear a mask, and it is important for me not to spread. And so, you know, it starts from there. Like how they say charity begins at home. Ethics starts from an individual, and ethics goes to institutions, and ethics goes to countries. And that's how I think, you know, we sustainable development and sustainable development goals and all these that we talk about starts somewhere at the grassroots level. And there is that one individual who would be beginning it. So it's important for us to not only learn, but to practice and implement it. So I think that would be my concluding remark for today's lecture. And thanks a lot for this interaction.
Thank you, Ramya ma'am. To the participants, basically what we have done today, I'll just sum up in a few words. First is, engineers are inherent part of the society, and they shall hold the paramount as the safety, health, and welfare of the public. These are the three pillars which should be, I think, on the top priority of engineers. And ethics are not always black and white, but yes, as Vishnath sir has just mentioned, it is zero and one. We can be very near to black and white, but in wherever the situation is, like, we can decide that which side we have to choose. If it is not black and white, if it's a shade of gray, then we can apply our frameworks and find out how beneficial, keeping in mind the three principles, safety, health, and welfare of the public. These three principles we can decide upon the passing a particular project or a product, then or saying no to it. Then we have discussed about importance and significance of ethics in industry in the post-COVID world. While talking about this, we have discussed the, in brief, we have discussed the three, four models, that is utilitarian, deontological, under which we have talked about Kantian model, then fairness and justice and virtues. So this is a kind of overall things which we have discussed, taking up the questions raised by the participants at different forums. There is no end to the questions. If you, whenever you come across, you see this video and find out any questions, please put up these questions in the discussion forums on the MOOCs portal. These will be taken up by both the experts whenever they find time. Don't panic, just wait. You will definitely find out the answers for your questions. Post them on the discussion forums and wait patiently for these to be answered. And this video is available on YouTube, as well as this will be posted on the platform for your convenience to visit the video, get benefited from this video, and move ahead with enhancing our life skills in ethical understanding of ethical values, ethical systems, so that we can apply it in the field, whichever field we are, not just engineering, in any field we are, we can apply it. I would like to thank both the speakers who have really taken out time in the morning hours, which are really hurry up hours for all of us. Thank you, sir, and thank you, Ramya ma'am, for this beautiful and very, very interactive presentation, and very connected presentation with the real life. Because both the topics, whether I'm talking about the ethical this thing and its implementation in the field, whether it's engineering or we can apply it anywhere, it is very, very connecting to us directly. So thank you, both of you. I'll request all the participants to complete the modules as well as the quizzes on time, so that you can get your certificate of completion or participation, whichever you are aiming for. and do participate in the discussion forums, not just for your understanding, but for us also to learn through your questions. No question is a bad question or a foolish question. It is a very good question. So please keep posting on the portal. Last but not the least, I would like to put forward my thanks to Dr. Manas Ranjan Panigrahi, SPO SEMCA, and Professor Ramabrahmam, who is not available present here, but he has given his all the support for this MOOC, and Ms. Ramya is there to represent him. Thank you very much, sir. And thank you to IIT Kanpur for this portal. Thank you very much. And now we'll be signing off. Last but not the least, thank you all the participants and my speakers. Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Monica, for conducting it so well. Thanks to SEMCA from all of us and the team of ethics team from the team that worked on ethics module. So
yeah.
Thanks
the
so
whole-
much.
We are a team. Yes, we ourselves are a team. So thank you very much. Thank you, Vishwanath sir. Thank you, Ramya ma'am. Bye-bye. Signing off for now.